السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين دنيا میں
There is not a single human in the world who is completely bereft of any type of flaws and shortcomings. It is actually the attribute of Allah of Sattar that covers our weaknesses. If man's faults, deficiencies, and sins were laid bare, he would find it impossible to save face before anyone at all. Allah the Almighty, who is the Sattarul Ayub, the coverer of man's failings and the Ghafarul Zunub, the forgiver of man's sins, has favored us by teaching us a prayer so that we may strive to overcome our shortcomings and deficiencies. He has said we should also engage in istighfar, seeking forgiveness from Him for our sins. Then He will forgive us of our sins, and will conceal our failings, and He will listen to our prayers. On a general level, Allah the Almighty conceals many of the transgressions of man. However, Allah the Almighty's cloak of forgiveness envelops especially those who engage in istighfar, seeking forgiveness from Him for one's sins. The meaning of ghafar is to cover and to conceal, and more or less the same meaning applies to satr. The promised Messiah, alayhi salam, peace be upon him, says at one place that the image of God presented by Islam and whom Muslims believe in is the one who is Rahim, the merciful, Kareem, the generous, Halim, the forbearing, the Tawwab, offer upturning with compassion, and Ghaffar, the forgiving. Allah the Almighty accepts the repentance and forgives the sins of one who sincerely repents. However, we see in the world that whether it pertains to one's real brother, whether it relates to one's close relative or friend or acquaintance, he will always be seen with that blemish he was at fault with in the past, regardless of him now desisting from committing that wrongdoing again. Thus, to people in the world, even when a man desists from performing a sin, others still persist in seeing him in light of that past blemish, and they continue to view him with suspicion. The promised Messiah, peace be upon him, says, "However, observe how kind and generous is Allah the Almighty, that He forgives man despite him committing thousands of transgressions. There is no person in the world, save the messengers of God, who are absolutely absorbed in the color of God, and who overlook the fault of others to such a degree." In other words, no one overlooks the faults of others to the extent God does. Only the prophets, after God, do so to such a degree, and no one else. The promised Messiah says that, in fact, generally the situation is, as Sa'di has stated in his couplet of poetry, that God Almighty conceals our flaws and our shortcomings despite being fully cognizant of them. Whereas, as soon as a person learns of a mistake or fault of his neighbor, he will publicize it as much as he possibly can. Here, the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, has quoted from a verse of poetry of Sa'di. At one place, the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, has explained this by saying, "The attribute of God of overlooking the other's faults operates by God, despite observing man's faults and sins, concealing his faults, until a time when man transgresses beyond the limits of moderation. Yet man, without even witnessing another committing a wrongdoing, begins raising a hue and cry about the other person." So the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, says, "Reflect on how great is God's attributes of mercy and generosity. If Allah the Almighty were to hold man to account for everything he committed and perpetrated, he would destroy all mankind. However, his mercy and his favor is all-encompassing, and it supersedes his punishment. Thus, if all were to understand this and were to refrain from constantly searching for the weaknesses and shortcomings in others, whether brothers, friends, or anyone else they interact with, it would eventually lead to the formation of a loving and peaceful society." There are many among us who, instead of concealing the faults of others, go around trying to expose the flaws in others. Yet, when anyone speaks ill against them, or they find out from some source or the other that someone has said something about them, they become extremely enraged and furious, to the degree that they are prepared to fight or kill that other person. However, when they themselves speak ill of others, they will brush it off by simply saying that they had only said it lightly and it did not mean anything. We should always keep in mind the following statement of the Holy Prophet, may the peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, who said that you should desire for others what you desire for yourself. Thus, if you want others to overlook your flaws and weaknesses, then you should wish the same for them as well. This is the golden principle that is the essential ingredient for a peaceful society. And so when you see weaknesses in someone, instead of publicizing his flaws, you should focus instead on engaging in istighfar, seeking forgiveness from Allah for one's sins. Allah the Almighty is completely without need, and thus we should be fearful lest our countless inner flaws and defects are ever uncovered. If one conceals someone else's failings with sincere intentions, it will lead him to attaining the grace and blessings of Allah the Almighty. Always remember this statement of the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, when he said that if Allah the Almighty were to hold man to account and punish him for everything he does, he would end up destroying all of mankind. Thus, this is a very frightening matter, and we should always give attention to engaging in istighfar, seeking forgiveness from Allah for our sins. The Holy Prophet ﷺ, may the peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, said on one occasion that one who conceals the failings of one of his brothers will have his own failings concealed by Allah the Almighty on the Day of Judgment and will overlook his faults. And one who exposes the shortcomings of others, who sees someone transgressing and then goes around telling others about it, he will have his own shortcomings exposed by Allah the Almighty and will be disgraced in his own home. Thus, this is a severe warning and is a matter to be terrified of. To attract the blessings of Allah, you should avoid constantly engaging in fault-finding in others. Instead, scrutinize your own condition. Only then can we attain the mercy and blessings of Allah. Some people say that if we do not expose the shortcomings that we see in others, then how can we help those individuals to reform? Always remember that if someone's transgressions and wrongdoings are causing harm to the Nizam-e-Jamaat, the system of the community, or if someone's actions are seriously corrupting a section of people, then this matter should be reported to the appointed individuals within the community for reformation, such as the Amir, the National President, or the Sadr, the local president. Or you can write to me, so that attention to reformation can be given. Allah the Almighty does not wish for the system of the community that He has established to be ruined. He does not desire for the wrongdoing of one individual to become a common weakness within the wider society. This is why Allah the Almighty exposes the shortcomings of such individuals. The Promised Messiah, peace be upon him, has said that this applies to such individuals who persist stubbornly in committing transgressions and spreading them openly. As the Promised Messiah, peace be upon him, has said that Allah the Almighty observes man committing sins and transgressions. However, he continues to conceal those sins under this attribute until a time when man breaks the limits of moderation. So when man himself exposes his misdeeds and breaks the limits of moderation, he thereby initiates Allah the Almighty's attribute of punishment. Once man exposes himself in this manner, he is then chastised by Allah the Almighty, if he so wishes, in both this world and in the hereafter. In any case, to publicize someone's flaws and failings is certainly forbidden, because this only leads to sins to spread, rather than being eliminated. One should always keep in mind the statement of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, may the peace and blessings of Allah be upon him in this regard, who said that if you constantly search out for the others' weaknesses, it will lead to those others to becoming corrupted. This relates to when one is always on the lookout for someone else's faults, and then relates these shortcomings wherever he goes. If one acts in this fashion, it leads to those people becoming corrupted, and it also destroys the peace of the society. And by then mentioning someone else's flaws and failures amongst others, it leads to the person with the flaw to becoming even more stubborn in his ways, rather than trying to reform. And then by stubbornly persisting in his ways, the individual will then try to convert others to act in the way he does, and the circle of people he influences continues to widen. When one's cover is exposed, then reformation also ceases. And so here I would like to also draw the attention of those who have been entrusted with the work of the Jamaat, of the Ahmadiyya community, especially those departments tasked with reformation. They must carry out the work of reformation, treading extremely carefully and also with immense compassion and sympathy. No one should feel that their shortcomings have been exposed and revealed to others by any office bearer. If anyone happens to feel this way, it will lead to a very serious backlash. If those people entrusted with reforming others instead expose the faults of people, they will be the cause of others in the society becoming corrupted on the one hand, whilst on the other, they will be incurring the displeasure of Allah the Almighty. Allah the Almighty will say that, "I have given you such an opportunity to serve the Jamaat so that you can reflect the attributes of Allah the Almighty as much as possible." However, such people in reality would be acting in the opposite manner to Allah's attribute of Sattar, of covering the faults of others, and thereby they will become the means of creating anxiety and disorder. How pleased is Allah the Almighty with this act of concealing the faults of others, and the rewards He grants to one who does this act can be gauged from the saying of the Holy Prophet, may the peace and blessings of Allah be upon him. The Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam stated on one occasion that a Muslim is a brother of a fellow Muslim and cannot commit any cruelty or injustice against him, and nor does one abandon and disown the other. Regrettably, nowadays we find that the most cruelty and injustice perpetrated against the Muslims is by the Muslims themselves, and they are spilling the blood of one another. None of them pays heed to this instruction of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, may the peace and blessings of Allah be upon him. Anyways, the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam further stated that one who remains occupied in serving his brothers, Allah the Almighty will continue to fulfill his needs, and one who alleviates the troubles of a fellow Muslim, Allah the Almighty will lessen one affliction from the afflictions of the Day of Judgment. And one who covers the sins of a Muslim, Allah the Almighty will cover his sins on the Day of Judgment. Thus, in order to attain the mercy and benevolence of the merciful and benevolent God, it is necessary to cover up and conceal the faults and sins of others. Then the Holy Prophet, may the peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, also stated that whosoever covers the sins of another person in this world, Allah the Almighty will undoubtedly cover his sin on the Day of Judgment. In other words, Allah the Almighty certainly rewards a person who covers the sins of others. If someone covers the faults or sins of others, then Allah the Almighty will register the virtuous deed of such a person, and he shall find his reward on the Day of Judgment. Allah the Almighty will overlook the faults of such a person. In fact, Allah the Almighty is so gracious and covers such a person with his shade of mercy to such a degree that according to one narration, it is reported that Allah the Almighty will ask the believer, "Did you commit such and such act?" The believer will reply, "Yes, my Lord, I did." Upon this, Allah the Almighty will state, "I covered your weaknesses and did not disclose your sins to the world. And today, on the Day of Judgment, I will again cover your shortcomings and transgressions and sins, and I shall forgive you. Thus, this is the treatment that Allah the Almighty affords to His servants. Thus, if we seek to derive the blessings of Allah the Almighty's attribute of a Sattar, the one who conceals the faults of others, then it is imperative that we also adopt this attribute and cover the faults and shortcomings of others. No one should entertain the idea that others are full of shortcomings and you are free of them. It is purely due to the grace of Allah the Almighty that He has concealed our sins. One must always remember the words of the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, in this regard, who stated, "In actuality, it is Allah the Almighty who covers the sins and shortcomings of man, because He is a Sattar. It is due to Allah the Almighty's attribute of a Sattar, which has enabled so many people to be seen or deemed as pious. Otherwise, had Allah the Almighty not concealed our sins, then our countless internal blemishes would have been exposed." Thus, this must always be kept in mind, and while reciting istighfar, seeking forgiveness from Allah for our sins, and seeking to be enwrapped in Allah the Almighty's forgiveness, there one should also assess his own self and overlook the weaknesses of others. One should deeply reflect about his own state and also not expose other people's weaknesses. One should always assess himself and should always remember that just as Allah the Almighty has covered his own shortcomings, in the same way he must cover the shortcomings of others. The promised Messiah, peace be upon him, states, "The perfection of one's faith is achieved by adopting the attributes of God. In other words, one should try and adhere to the attributes of Allah the Almighty to the best of one's abilities and should seek to instill His attributes within him." The promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wasalam, on whom BP states, "For instance, Allah the Almighty is forgiving. Therefore, one should also inculcate the habit of overlooking and forgiving others. Allah is merciful, forbearing, and gracious. Therefore, man should also treat others with mercy, forbearance, and kindness. Allah the Almighty is Sattar, the one who covers the faults of others. And therefore, man should also partake of this attribute of Sattar and should cover the faults and sins of his brothers and others." The promised Messiah, peace be upon him, further states, "Certain people have a habit that when they see a wrong or a weakness in someone, they cannot rest until they have publicized it and spread it everywhere thoroughly." It has been related in the Hadith, the tradition of the Holy Prophet, that one who covers the faults of his brother, Allah the Almighty will cover his faults. One should not be so impudent and immoral, and nor treat others ill. Rather, one should treat them with love and affection and piety. Once during a gathering in the presence of the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, the faults of a particular person were being recounted. The promised Messiah, peace be upon him, heard this, and addressing the person who was saying this, said, "You have passionately mentioned and described such and such person's weaknesses. However, it would have been better had you instead mentioned his good qualities. Surely he must have some good qualities which you could have mentioned." Therefore, in order to establish a society free from ills and to promote peace and love, it is necessary to cover the faults of others and instead speak of their good qualities. By speaking of one's good qualities, it will become a source of inspiration for others and also do good. This is the role of a true Muslim, that they should spread piety in their surroundings. It is a grievous sin to publicize and spread the fault of others simply for one's pleasure and to create a seemingly light-hearted atmosphere. It is a huge sin to mock and deride someone in a gathering, and this is something that every Ahmadi should refrain from. We have entered into the bayat, the oath of initiation of the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, and we have pledged to cause no harm whatsoever to others, neither by our hands nor our tongues. Thus it is imperative to adhere to this. The wound caused to others by one's speech and words does not heal for a very long time. At times, deriding another person and exposing his faults can have a very long-lasting impact. Therefore, we need to take great caution and we should develop true sympathy and compassion for our fellow brother in our hearts. However, we can only demonstrate true sympathy and compassion if we cover the faults and weaknesses of our fellow brothers. And we should never expose and reveal their shortcomings, neither in a light-hearted tone and nor in a serious manner. Indeed, owing to one's true sympathy, it requires and necessitates that if we see a weakness in someone, then we should try to reform him so that the ill or weakness can be removed from that person. And so also it safeguards the society if that ill is having a harmful impact on the wider population and society. This, in fact, is true piety, and it enables one to attract the grace of Allah the Almighty. What are the promised Messiah, peace be upon him's expectations from us in this regard? The promised Messiah, peace be upon him, states, if one notices a weakness in someone, then he should advise him discreetly. That is, one should take him to the side and impart the advice quietly. But if he does not follow it, then one should pray for that person. One should give advice, and if he acts upon it, then that is all well and good. But if he does not, then one should pray for him. However, if both these things have no effect, neither from the advice and nor from the prayer, then what should one do? The promised Messiah says that consider this as a divine decree. Consider it to be the will of God the Almighty. If Allah the Almighty has accepted someone, then you need not to express momentary passion after witnessing him commit any fault or weakness. Allah the Almighty has accepted him and granted him the opportunity to accept the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, and to enter his community, his Jamaat. And despite the humiliation he should have faced in your estimation, he has not experienced that disgrace, and his faults are being concealed in some way or another, and only you have knowledge of this. Then you do not need to show so much passion for his faults, and you should remain quiet. Allah the Almighty himself will provide the means for his reformation. The promised Messiah states it is possible that such a person will reform one day. Thus from this, it is evident that according to the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, a person who has become Ahmadi and entered into his bayat, his pledge of allegiance, shows that Allah the Almighty has accepted him. Therefore, no one has the right to search for such a person's personal flaws and then reveal and expose them to others. A person should not pry into a person's private affairs and then publicize their ills or publicly show aversion to that person. The promised Messiah, peace be upon him, states that it is possible that such a person may reform. At another place, the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, says in continuation of this, at times even the saints and the holy personages can err. The prominent saints and sages can also commit a wrong act. In fact, it has been written that even the saints can commit adultery, and there have been many thieves, adulterers, who eventually became saints and sages. The promised Messiah, peace be upon him, states, it is not our practice to be haste and quick in abandoning someone. If someone's child is ill-behaved, one makes every effort to bring about the child's reformation. In this same way, one should not be so hasty in abandoning his fellow brother. Just as one seeks to reform his own child, in the same way one should try and remove the ills and faults of his fellow brother. One should make an effort and also pray for them. In fact, an effort should be made to bring about a reformation in them. The promised Messiah states, the teachings of the Holy Quran certainly do not state that one should promote the faults and weaknesses of others and discuss them amongst others. In fact, it states, تَوَاسَوْ بِالصَّبْرِ وَتَوَاسَوْ بِالْمَرْحَمَةِ, that they exhort one another with patience and mercy. The promised Messiah states that marhama, or mercy, is that when one sees a blemish in someone, he should advise them and pray for them. Prayer contains great vigor. The promised Messiah states that prayer contains great vigor. The state of that individual is very pitiful who can announce the fault on another one hundreds of times, yet does not pray for him even once. One should only mention the fault of another individual when one weeps in prayer for them at least for 40 days. Now, by mentioning this, it does not mean that one should readily expose people's shortcomings or that one has the permission to spread them openly. In fact, it means that if one has to raise the issue with those responsible for reformation, then before making a complaint, one should pray and strive to the utmost for that person. The promised Messiah states, we do not imply that one should approve of the shortcoming or that when one sees a fault in another, he should support it by declaring it to be a really good act and say, well done, and that if anyone has a fault or weakness, it is not that it becomes a good deed somehow. One should not endorse the shortcoming. However, at the same time, one should not publicize it nor backbite regarding it. If one witnesses a fault, then they should not spread that fault in the person, nor should they proclaim that shortcoming of that person in front of others. Because it has been stated in the Book of Allah, the Quran, that it is a sin to announce others' shortcomings and to backbite. The promised Messiah further states, Sheikh Sadi had two students. One of them was very intelligent and would articulate points of wisdom and truths. He would impart wisdom and knowledge, whilst the other would burn with jealousy, owing to his own inability. He would become very bitter. That is, one of the students was very wise, whereas the other was less intelligent. As I mentioned previously, the less intelligent student exhibited jealousy towards the student who was more intelligent. Eventually, the former intelligent student mentioned to Sheikh Sadi that whenever I mention something, the other student is overcome with jealousy. Upon hearing this, Sheikh Sadi replied, if owing to his jealousy, one chose the path that leads towards hell, that is, one chooses the path that will lead him to hell due to his jealousy. But you are also guilty of backbiting. The fact that you are telling me is not a virtuous deed. You have also adopted the path towards hell because of your backbiting. Thus, both of you are guilty of sin. Having mentioned this incident, the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, then stated, this dispensation cannot flourish unless we adopt mercy, prayer, concealing the faults of others and exhorting one another to show mercy. Thus, on the one hand, we affirm that by entering into the Bayt, the Pledge of Allegiance with the promised Messiah, we will bring about pious changes within ourselves. Yet on the other hand, if we have succumbed to worldly and materialistic pursuits and influences in our surroundings, and we fail to implement the teachings and attributes of God Almighty upon ourselves, then we would be guilty of sin by virtue of not fulfilling our pledge. We would fail to become those individuals whom the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, wished us to become. What did the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, wish for us to become? It was that we should adopt mercy for one another, and that we should become those who pray for one another and conceal each other's shortcomings. On one occasion, the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, stated, "Our Jamaat, our community, should act in a manner that when anyone witnesses the fault of another, they should pray for that person. However, if they do not pray for them and instead announce the fault of it in a manner that it becomes thoroughly exposed, then they would be guilty of a sin." The promised Messiah states, "What are the shortcomings that can't be overcome? Therefore, one should always assist their fellow brother by praying for them. When we assist each other in this manner, and instead of exposing the weakness of others and revealing their faults, we begin to pray for them, only then will we become that true community that the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, wished for us to become." Furthermore, this is the sign of a true Muslim, as mentioned in the sayings of the Holy Prophet, may the peace and blessings of Allah be upon him. This is the very condition that can lead to our salvation, forgiveness, and allow for our faults to be concealed. The Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has taught us a prayer that can grant us the protection of God Almighty and enable us to become the recipients of His divine blessings. Therefore, we should recite this constantly. The prayer is, "O Allah, I implore from you that you protect me in this life and in the hereafter. O my Lord, grant me security and shield me in my faith, in worldly matters, in wealth, and in my household. O Allah, conceal my shortcomings and bestow peace upon me by removing my fears. O Allah, protect me yourself from all dangers and encompass me in your security from all directions, whether it is from the front, from behind me, from my right, my left, or even above. I seek the shelter of your majesty, lest I fall prey to any concealed difficulties." Thus, we should pray for ourselves in this manner. We should also pray for others with the same sentiments. And when this situation arises, then God Almighty will readily accept the prayers of us. May Allah the Almighty enable us to become among those who seek His pleasure. After the prayers, I will lead a funeral prayer in absentia, which is of Mr. Malik Salim Latif Sahib, who was an advocate, as well as the president of the Jamaat of Nankana Sahib in Pakistan. He was the son of Mr. Malik Muhammad Shafi Sahib and was 70 years old at the time. Yesterday, that is the 30th of March 2017, he left his house at 9 a.m. to attend court, accompanied by his son. On the way, an enemy of Ahmadiyyat opened fire, and consequently he was martyred. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. To Allah we belong and to Him we shall return. Ahmadiyyat was introduced into the family of the deceased through two maternal uncles of his father, Mr. Malik Muhammad Shafi, Hadrat Hafiz Nabi Baksh, a companion of the promised Messiah, and Hadrat Jamaluddin Sahib, who was also a companion of the promised Messiah, peace be upon him. He belonged to Chak Sadullah, which is located close to Qadian. The deceased father was an Ahmadi by birth. Prior to the partition, he settled in Nankana Sahib. The deceased was born in Nankana Sahib in 1948. He obtained his early education from Nankana Sahib. In 1967, he completed his LLB from Lahore, and he had been working as a lawyer since then. According to the details, the deceased left home at 9 a.m. to go to court with his son, Muhammad Farhan, an advocate, by motorbike. His son was at front riding the motorcycle. When they reached the junction near the Berivala marketplace, an unknown individual signaled for them to stop. Due to the turn in the road, the motorbike was already at a relatively low speed. The aforementioned individual opened fire, which pierced the deceased's ribs on the right side. The attacker then reloaded and fired at his back, at which point the deceased fell from the motorbike. The attacker then fired at the son, narrowly missing him. Even after this, he continuously fired at him, but failed in his attempts. His son began reciting the kalama out loud. The people standing nearby did not make any attempt to intervene. Rather, they stood there watching the events unfold. He was unable to reload his gun and stopped firing, at which point he fled from the scene. However, during this time, owing to his injuries, the deceased embraced martyrdom. At the time of the partition, the deceased's father worked as a supervising Tehsildar revenue inspector, and as a result of this, he assisted greatly in relocating many Ahmadis to Nankana Sahib after the partition. One area of Nankana was established by Ahmadis and was named Kucha Ahmadiyya. Nevertheless, in 1974, a law was passed against the Jamaat, and under pressure from the opponents, its name was changed from Kucha Ahmadiyya to Gaddafi Street. From 1977 up until his martyrdom, with the exception of 1 year, the deceased had the opportunity to serve as the Sadr, the president of Nankana Jamaat. The deceased possessed many qualities. He was a very sociable and hospitable person. Aside from showing hospitality to the guests from the markaz and the center, compassion for the poor was an evident trait of his. He was ever ready to help everyone. He was regular in his prayers and had a special connection with Khilafat. He was a brave and courageous individual. Alongside the other members of the Jamaat, he faced severe persecution. In 1989, many Ahmadi homes, including the home of the deceased, were ransacked and set on fire by the opponents. Despite all these circumstances, he always remained steadfast and confronted the opponents valiantly. In 2010, he had the opportunity to assist in the building of a local mosque. The wife of the deceased also had the opportunity to serve as a Sadr Lajna, and passed away only a few years earlier. The late father-in-law of the deceased was Malik Muhammadin Sahib, whose name was mentioned in the well-known proceedings against the Jamaat in Sahiwal, and later passed away whilst he was still in custody. The deceased is survived by two sons, Malik Oves, who is a civil judge in Lahore, and Muhammad Farhan, who is an advocate and currently serves as the Qayyad of Khuddam al-Ahmadiyya. He is also survived by one daughter, Dr. Samra Waqar Sahiba, who resides in Lahore. He has three brothers and three sisters. One of his brothers, Malik Muhammad Naseem Sahib, lives here in London. The father of the deceased and the mother of Dr. Abdul Salam Sahib were relatives. In light of the wish of the family of the deceased, he is buried in his ancestral town of Sahiwal. May Allah the Almighty elevate the status of the deceased, and may He enable His children to follow in His footsteps and increase them in their virtuous deeds. May Allah the Almighty arrange for the swift capture of the opponents and enemies of Ahmadiyyat.
Alhamdulillah, nahmaduhu wa nasta'inuhu wa nastaghfiruhu wa nu'minu bihi wa natawakkalu alayhi wa na'udhu billahi min shururi anfusina wa min sayyiati a'malina من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله ونشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله عباد الله رحمكم الله إن الله يأمر بالعدل واللسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون اذكروا الله يذكركم وادعوه يستجب لكم ولذكر الله أكبر.